This is Brother Patrick, your favorite brother from another mother. It seems to be, I just wanted to say before I forget, it seems that we are, after my final analysis, that we are on a globe, brothers and sisters. Just a FYI there. No, Brother Sid and I decided to bring it on here and talk about it because, you know, I usually always make videos as just preaching. And then, made a video of Brother Gary and then Sister Linda Kirby and then Brother Sid because there's a big buzz on the internet now about this flat earth stuff if you haven't heard it. That's why I brought Brother Sid to come on and talk about the theory. We didn't endorse or discount or endorse the theory or the idea that people had because there's thousands of people who are, dozens and dozens of videos about it. And thousands of people are growing in this movement. That's why I had it on here, because it relates to creation. But of course, there are atheists who believe in the flat earth and everything's a conspiracy. And then there's Christians also. So I wanted to say two things. Number one, the Bible is not a scientific book. It's not written as a scientific observation, as I said in the flat earth video. And number two, the Bible does not say that the earth is flat. It says it's a circle. So that, you know, a circle can be a globe, or it could be, you know, like a ball, or it's just a circle, but, you know, like a flat disc. But I found some proof because I prayed about it, brothers and sisters, you know, because people, you know, you guys are always asking me to pray for a word from the Lord. So I prayed to the Lord and said, Lord, can you please, lead me in the wisdom of this thing, because it's a big deal in the Christian community. Some of you guys haven't heard of it. You don't know it, but it is. And so I prayed, and I believe the Lord kept telling me it was a globe. So I said, well, Lord, you know, I want to make sure it's you because this is a big thing for lots of people. It's very important. Lots of you guys, it's not important, but for others it is. So I prayed, and then the Lord told me specifically to check some flight schedules, brothers and sisters. So I checked the flight schedule, and the Lord gave me the places, Santiago, Chile to Sydney, Australia. And you check for direct flights. Direct flights, because sometimes people say, oh, you know, if you check the flights, there's some that go to the northern hemisphere, then cut over. But there are direct flights. Qantas Airlines has direct flights from Santiago, Chile to Sydney, and then there's direct flights from South Africa, Johannesburg, South Africa, to on the west coast of Australia. I can't think of the name of the city now. The west coast of Australia, you can look, there's direct flights. The flight time from Santiago, Chile to Sydney, Australia is about 12 and a half hours, about 6,000 nautical miles. So on the flat earth model, brothers and sisters, this would be impossible. The flight time would be about 24 plus or to 30 hours. You know, it's all, if you look at the flat earth, those of you who are studying it, if you look at where Australia is in South America, they're diametrically opposed across the disc. They're like 30 or 40,000 kilometers apart. And so there would no way you could fly that in 12 hours. And there are direct flights from southern hemisphere countries, like from South Africa to Australia, as I also pointed out. It's like a nine or 10 hours, whatever it is. It's even shorter. So just that is an empirical fact that you could check yourself, you know, and see that you can book a flight and the times that would totally show that obviously the globe earth model is correct. Anyway, brothers and sisters, I just wanted to get that out there before I forgot. So in the title of this video, I'm sure that I put something about our dear brother from another mother out there on the left coast, as we say, or the west coast area. Our brother Bear, Gary, is here with us. And the thing is, brothers and sisters, it's so awesome. The last week, Brother Gary and I have been talking and praying for the last several days. And the Lord has been giving us so many awesome revelations. Gary and I both said we wish we had been recording it because the Lord has been giving us wisdom at whole new levels that I've never heard before and that we've never made in videos. And so I invited Brother Gary. I said, let's make a little radio show as the Lord would lead us. And let's see if the Lord will let us get into that stuff for public, you know, for the church to hear, our brothers and sisters in Christ. And so Brother Gary's here, and I'm going to let Brother Gary say whatever the Lord is leading him to say, of course, and we'll run with it by the grace of God. Okay, Brother Gary, I pray the Lord will make a way to use us in this video to bring glory to his name and bring, fresh manna to the bride, to the church. We ask it in Jesus' name. Amen. Hey, Brother Gary.
Yes, I, you know, I really, I don't, I think we need to have some kind of a, maybe an itinerary about this. You know, there were so many things, Patrick, that you and I had discussed. You know, it was, you know, really mind-blowing the amount of Holy Spirit-led information that the Lord was talking to us about, you know, over these, you know, past few days, and even over these, you know, past few months. We, you know, we talked about, you know, about the Lord and how he has somehow, he's seen each one of us before we were born. He knew us, you know, before we were ever conceived. And so there was some type of a, you know, pre-existence with him where he formed us and decided who we were going to be and what our destinies were going to be. And, you know, we discussed that, and we talked about, you know, there are scriptures that even point to this, but it's really not, you know, taught. There are so many people in the theological circles that, you know, they just walk over this because it's very hard to understand. It's like what Paul was talking about, you know, about predestination and these things that are, you know, so hard to understand. We have free will, but yet God has chosen us to do certain things. And, you know, like he talked about even Judas, how that, you know, he was destined for this thing that he did, but it would have been better for him had he not been born. And, you know, we were talking about those things and about, you know, just so many things that are going on that are current with the world right now, and you know, what the New World Order is doing. And you know, I think the focus of the whole thing was that God is trying to do this work in our lives, you know, and so many people, you know, I know the big focus for the past 4 years really in my life has been the fact that the Lord had told me that, you know, he was coming soon. And, you know, I had, you know, you and I have talked about my own life and how I had, you know, I was a Christian and then I, you know, backslid. And then in 1991, I was fasting for 10 days and the Lord woke me up in the middle of the night and asked me to pray for the neighbor across the street for the workmanship of his hands. And the Lord told me at that time, the very next day, that he was going to give me this job and I was going to work for the fire department in law enforcement, and that the chief was going to call me in 3 days personally and offered me this job, and that I would work there for 10 years. And then he told me that I would work in the oil fields for 1 year after that. And then he said, after that, you'll do my will. But the point of all that is at that time, he did not mention at all that he was coming soon or any of these other things that he spoke to me. And so for 19 years, even after the Lord did that, and there were some miracles that happened, and, you know, like many Christians, we ebb and we flow in our lives, you know, and you reach this peak and then you're, you know, the Lord kind of backs off of you and you feel, you know, like he's really not there that much. And then you do things that you shouldn't do, and you know, you become lukewarm and you backslide. And so that, you know, that happens to a great majority of us. And that happened to me. And then for 19 years, the Lord didn't speak to me really, you know, that I knew of. And then in 2011, you know, he spoke to me and told me to stop what I was doing and repent and to get my house in order, that he was coming soon. And so, you know, you and I were talking about this and about You know, there's a great deal of confusion, I believe, in people's lives right now about the closeness of the Lord. You know, is he truly coming? And so you know, the great focus is this, in these are truly the last days, because, you know, the Lord, I asked him about that. I said, you know, are you coming as in my soon or is in your soon? And so then he gave me a dream and told me that whenever they came to take my home and they proposed to take his, that I would know that it was the end of time. There was no more time left. And that's in my personal testimony. People can see that on my channel. And the main point of that is, you know, this was like any story where people say that, you know, some miracle has happened or some great thing has happened in someone's lives, you know, and it's, you know, personal credibility. Do you believe this person? You know, do you believe what they're saying? And, you know, you and I have gone this back and forth about what we believed, you know, and the soonness of the Lord, and what does this mean? And, you know, we are just like all of these other people, except that, you know, we are willing, you know, as voices for the Lord, we're willing to say we don't really know, you know, and we do have doubts. And so we, through prayer, go before the Lord and ask him, you know, what is the truth here, God? And, you know, I believe that all things are pointing to him coming soon. You see, he told me that he was coming soon, and this was different, this time that we're talking about right now, these last few years, you know. And in the very beginning, I, you know, in 2011, I thought, well, surely he's coming this year. And I kind of discounted that thing about losing my home, because I had a very low house payment and I didn't pay electrical bill because I had solar equipment on my home. And so I didn't have to pay for electricity, and I still ended up losing my home. And it's been a process of them, you know, taking title to it and doing all these things. So he said, when they come to take your home, you know, then you will know that it is the end of time. And when they propose to take his, and that's exactly what's going on with this whole thing in Israel. You know, the Palestinians want the Temple Mount and East Jerusalem, and that's the last place that God's house stood on earth in Israel.
Right.
So we were talking about all these kind of things, you know, and about the needs of the church and how, you know, the church has been so lacks at times, you know, to provide for the people what God said that we were to do, you know, to take care of the widows and you know, these children, the orphans, like you're doing, Patrick, and, you know, all of these things that God gave us to do as jobs, you know, and as individuals, how each and every person that's out there can take personal responsibility for someone near them, or for, you know, not only just preaching the gospel, but when you see somebody that's cold or that needs a jacket or that needs some kind of help, you can reach out to that person and not just say, well, in the name of the Lord, be clothed or be warmed or whatever. You know, our job really is to show them the love of Christ by, you know, providing for their physical needs and then speaking to them about salvation.
Right, right.
Yeah, so
that's what James says, yeah.
I mean, there's so much, Patrick, that needs to be spoken, that people really need to know, you know. And then, and we see all these things like you and I were talking about earlier today about the work that's going on at CERN and what they're doing with these, you know, the interdimensional capabilities of that equipment, and how scientists are frightened, because even Stephen Hawking, who is a leading scientist, is, you know, under the belief that they could tear a hole in the space-time fabric or in the Earth itself. And, you know, these are very dangerous times that we live in. And we were, you know, you and I were talking about the studies that you had done on this equipment and on, you know, this whole, the whole hidden thing, because it's on a multiple level thing. You know, you have the Illuminati and the Masons and those people who are involved in all these things. And then there's also the scriptural level, see, and so there's just so many different levels.
Right, yeah, that was the things that the Lord was showing, like what you just covered was like, I mean, the thing about it that I wish we had recorded bef the other day, but you just don't know when the Lord's really going to move. But it's like, you know, the Lord has given you a piece, and then He's given me a piece, and then when we put it together and see where the Lord is going with it, it's it goes into things that that's beyond anything that I could do with my natural knowledge and understanding, like what we talked about, these different levels of you know, like the what we said in the Bible, as an example, it's all interconnected. But let me see if I can get going here, as this Lord would give me the unction to do. Like one thing, when we were talking earlier today, the Lord was just giving me all these nuggets, like you know, Judas was a type of Lucifer. You know what Jesus did to Lucifer, or what G Lucifer did to the Father, is kind of like what Judas did to the Lord Jesus Christ, the Son. So he
Yes.
was, you know, a type of that, because Lucifer was at the table of the Father. He was the anointed cherub that covered. He served right in the intimate presence of the Father, and he betrayed him and wanted to rebel and take over. And then here is Judas, one of the 12 disciples, sitting at the table of the Lord, even, you know, dipping his bread and right behind the Lord, in the Last Supper, and yet he betrayed the Lord Jesus Christ. And there's just so many levels, brothers and sisters. It's beyond comprehension. I guess it's coming into my mind now, these other things that is all connected. And what I told you, Brother Gary, the other day is I would love to put this out, because I know there's at least one brother in Minneapolis, and there's another sister, Sister Nikki, who I know the Lord has used in the past many times to give feedback, and the Lord had used them to do research. Because, you know, maybe me and you, Gary, even though we can research, maybe it's not, we're not, there's other people that have more talent in the area of research, diligent research, than you and I might have. Because if you know, as the Bible says, the hand can't say to the foot, I don't need you, you know. So
Yes.
we're a team. The body of Christ, we're a team. And the Bible says there's wisdom in the multitude of counsel. So if I'm getting these ideas from the Lord, I can't also be simultaneously researching. If I'm getting a new idea, I can't be researching the one I got before at the same time, you know, all at the same time. So I thank the Lord for YouTube, and I thank the Lord for brothers and sisters in Christ who are good at this area. So the things that the Lord told me, if I can remember, Gary, you can probably help me, that's the connection here. And and one of the connections, brothers and sisters, is and it's all these messages. The Lord gave me like 10 different great messages, and I just want to cover them quickly, that as I remember them. There's Father Abraham, and what the Lord was saying is that we, you know, we should really operate in the faith of Abraham. And the Apostle Paul talks about that in Romans chapter 4, in these end times. Because, you know, Abraham, it says in Romans 4, you know, he staggered not at the, you know, the promises of God. You know, he says he believed God when God said, you know, leave your family, go into a place that I'll show you, into a foreign land, and I'll show you, and I will make you the father of many nations. And it says Abraham's, you know, believed God, and it was counted unto him for righteousness. So Abraham, as the Apostle Paul discusses in that chapter 4 and on down through Romans chapter 4 through 6 or so, he's talking about this, and basically it's this. Abraham was in a covenant with God that God did himself, even before God gave him circumcision at the time of the birth of Isaac. Abraham had already made a covenant with God. God had already made a covenant with him. You know, he caused Abraham to fall into a deep sleep, and then he had Abraham to provide these pigeons and things like that. And then God came as a burning furnace, and God passed between those parts. And that's the kind of things they did in the ancient world. He had like these different animals he had split in half, and God passed between the parts of those animals. So that was a covenant that God made himself. God made that covenant with Abraham before he ever gave him the covenant of circumcision. And God counted Abraham as righteous because he believed him when he told him that I will make you the father of many nations if you obey me and go into this land that I'll show you. And then later on, God had him to offer up Isaac as a sacrifice. As I've talked about in videos before, of course, Isaac is a type of Christ. He carried his own wood. And I talked about that with Sister Linda on the radio show we did the other day, how that we don't see Isaac again until he meets his bride. His name is not mentioned again. So as Christ was crucified on the hill, he's not seen again, you know, until the church would see him at the rapture. And then, of course, he comes back to deal with Israel. And so there were so many different things here, brothers and sisters, as we cross over. So the bottom line of that message that the Lord gave me for you guys, which I will make another video preaching it as the Lord would lead me for everybody, is that we should walk as Abraham walked. You know, we're sojourners in a strange land. We are in a foreign land. Whatever country you're in, this earth is not our home, as it tells us in Hebrews chapter 11. We have a heavenly home, and it's not the earthly Jerusalem, but, you know, it's the new Jerusalem and the heavenly home that the Lord is preparing for us, John chapter 14. That is what the Lord wants us to do, as Abraham did. We offer ourselves as a living sacrifice, Romans chapter 12, you know, and that we would spend our time praising the Lord, worshiping the Lord, as there's a great list of things that we should be doing in light of the last days. In Ephesians chapter 5, you know, it says, you know, rejoice forevermore, pray without ceasing. All of those things there in 1 Thessalonians chapter 5 that the Apostle Paul tells us to do in the fact that we're living in the last days. And some of the other types that I would just like to run through just as a laundry list is the Lord has been showing me for years and years and years this connection, and I mentioned it a long time ago, between Joseph, as I mentioned in videos the other day, and a dear brother up there in Minneapolis had sent me some information on it about Nehemiah. Nehemiah, as the Lord keeps giving us the book Nehemiah to study, and it's about rebuilding Jerusalem. Nehemiah was a cupbearer for a Gentile king, and that also happens to be in a modern-day Iran. And he was on a place called the Ulai River. He was in the same palace that Esther was before him, a generation before him. And he was in the same palace that Daniel, a generation before that, had his vision of, you know, about the coming kingdoms and all these things, in the same exact place. Now, Joseph was in prison in Egypt, and a cupbearer, he interpreted the dream of the butler or the cupbearer for the king of Egypt. And as a result of that, he was called to interpret Pharaoh's dream. And then he ascended to the right hand of Pharaoh, and he became the viceroy of Egypt. And as I've talked about before in many videos, you know, he was sold for 30 pieces of silver like Jesus. He was not recognized by his brothers, the Israelites, the first time they came to Egypt to buy grain during the 7 years of famine. But the second time that they came to see him, he revealed himself that he was their brother Joseph. Same as the Lord, the second time the Lord will reveal himself to Israel when he comes back at the end of the age. He will reveal himself to Israel. But anyway, brothers and sisters, there's some many more connections. As I was talking to Brother Gary, as the Lord was reminding me of all these connections, Jacob had a well there in a place in the Old Testament. It's called Shechem. In the New Testament, it's there in Samaria. Now, Jacob gave that well to Joseph. Now, that same well here, so here's Joseph, who was really an Israelite, sitting in the place as a Gentile, and he was the ruler over all these Gentiles. Just as the Lord Jesus Christ in the church age, his kingdom is mainly Gentiles. And he is seated at the right hand of the Father, overseeing a kingdom of Gentiles, really the Gentile church. And so here is the Lord Jesus Christ, when he went to the woman at the well, John chapter 4, who was a Samaritan, which they were mixed blood people. They were not the true Israelites. That's why the Israelites rejected them, because the Samaritans, when the Assyrians scattered the northern kingdoms, they put people from other countries in that land. That's what they did. The Assyrians did. And so the Samaritans were mixed blood people. They were not the original tribes of Israel that were there. They were maybe mixed in with a remnant that was left there, but they were mixed blood people. That's why the Israelites didn't accept them, and that's why they didn't get along and the whole nine yards. They had a racial racism between each other. That's why when Jesus was there at the well, she said, you know, you being a Jew, and then you're asking me to give you water. You know, she was shocked about that. And That's why she asked Jesus where she should worship and all these things. But here is Jesus sitting on the well that Jacob gave to Joseph. And here he is, Jesus, the Jewish man, son of God, son of man, is asking for water and giving the gospel to this Gentile woman at that well. So it's kind of a reverse thing. So all these things are interconnected, brothers and sisters. And what the Lord is trying to show myself, along with what Brother Gary is saying, and Brother Gary's got other parts of this that we haven't even got to yet, as the Lord would bring it to our memory. You know, there's a lot of things here that connect the church, the bride's mission, and the mission of Israel, and what us watchers, what is our mission as we head in toward the tribulation period and the rapture and all that. So, brothers and sisters, I'm putting these things out there, and this is just a taste of it. Just a little part of it, brothers and sisters. There's so many more levels, as Brother Gary mentioned. Lord, show me about the esoterical side of this, about going to the CERN and how all that works, stargates and all these things. Gary, I'll just go for another minute about this while it's in my mind. Jacob, when he had his dream, you know, he had his dream there at Bethel. He changed the name of the place to Bethel because he said, you know, this is the house of God. When he saw the angels ascending and descending, and, you know, Jesus said later on, you know, in John to one of his disciples, he said, you know, hereafter you'll see the angels ascending and descending upon the Son of Man, referring to himself as the ladder or the way or the gate to heaven. You know, as he said in John chapter 10, you know, I am the gate. The sheep go in and out and find pasture through him. So he's the way, the truth, and the life. So what the Illuminati do, like in Masonry, they use Jacob's ladder. The Tower of Babel is like a Jacob's ladder. The DNA sequence is like a Jacob's ladder. It's leading to, you know, that's why God came down and stopped them from building the Tower of Babel, because their plan was not just to build a high tower. They, in their mind, they were trying to make a way to heaven. Like what Jacob saw when Jacob saw that ladder, you know, it's, you know, a way to get to heaven, you know, and spiritual, esoterical stuff. That's what they were trying to do. Just like as I've mentioned in videos a long time ago, and the Lord brought all this back to me about the alchemy. The lowest level of alchemy, turning lead to gold. But a higher level, beyond the initiate level of all these things, in masonry and alchemy and all this, the higher level is, of course, going from lead to gold is going from, you know, to incorruptible, from something that's useless in those days, lead being useless in those old days, going to gold, which is symbolic of eternity, immortality, incorruptibility. So becoming a god. And that's what the Mark of the Beast, I've made videos about this several times way back. The Mark of the Beast is going to be some kind of a DNA change in people. And then if the Lord wasn't returning, they would live like in the days of Noah. They would live to be 1,000 years old, because it's a DNA change for people who are seeking. And that's what the Google, you know, the Google head guy has been talking about, what the CERN and all that thing is about seeking eternal life without God. And you can look at these patterns on so many levels, brothers and sisters. And there's whole other levels that the Lord showed me too, about the pyramids and about and all these things, about the meridian and the rising and the setting of the sun. All these things that the esoteric people use as symbolism. You know, let me just say one more thing, and then I'm going to ask Gary to jump on here and run with it, whatever the Lord's leading him. But the thing is that the Tower of Babel, God confounded the languages. And so since that time, the reason why the Masonry and the Rosicrucians and the Knights Templar and all these esoterical groups, they use symbols, brothers and sisters, because it's a language. They're making their own language to bypass the fact that God took away their verbal communication. So they make universal symbols that they can recognize. And it's like a parable. Those symbols tell a whole story. And then every level higher you go into any of these mystery schools, as I said, Rosicrucians, Freemasonry, whatever, the higher level you go, the same symbol is used at an understanding that the lower levels are in the dark about. And the higher you go, the more you surrender your mind and your life to Satan. Ultimately, it's Luciferian worship. The more it will be revealed to you. And that's how all of these secret societies work. But we can go straight to the tree of life. We can go straight to the Lord Jesus Christ, get it straight from him, and put in perspective. This wisdom that they have, they're taking it out of perspective. They're seeing it as the end all to be all, when in reality, the wisdom that they've got is just like one drop in the bucket of God's wisdom, or one drop in the ocean of God's wisdom that he will freely share with us. That's why the Bible says, he who lacks wisdom, let him ask, for God loves to give it liberally. And that's in James. Jeremiah 33:3, God says, call upon me and I will answer you and show you great and mighty things that you know not. And that's what Gary and I have been trying to do. We've been seeking God. And that's the thing about it, brothers and sisters. And I know you've got a lot of people don't have time to do it. I know that. But there are other people, brothers and sisters, who want a shortcut when God knows they have time and God wants them to pray and seek him and read the Bible. But instead, they try to shortcut and run to and fro and try to get the rapture date or whatever they're trying to find from other people. And God's intention is, if you have time, seek God on your own, you know, your own relationship with the Lord, to hear from the Lord. That's what he wants ultimately from each person, as you have time. I know people busy with their jobs and all that. Of course, you know, you have to do what you have to do to take care of your family and whatnot. Anyway, Brother Gary, I've been talking a long time.
Hey. Well, you kind of stole my thunder right there. You know, that was my...
Did I? Well,
I was about to say the very same thing that you said.
Well, that shows you it's the Lord, man. It's the Lord.
Yeah. Seeking the Lord for themselves and, you know, trying to make supplication to the Father, you know, and find their way really in Christ for themselves. And, you know, that doesn't entail necessarily coming up with new ideas or any of these other things, but really what the Lord is talking about is spending time alone with Christ, you know, dedicated time. And I think, you know, even no matter who you are, there has to be some time that you can steal away for yourself to, you know, worship the Creator and to, you know, thank the Lord for what he's done for us. Because without that grace that he gives, this is a free thing that he's doing for us, that he chose us, you know. And so when you feel that tug on your heart and you feel that love of Christ pulling you and drawing you close to him, you know, that you spend time with him and make an effort to really dig in to Christ and tell him how you feel about him, and tell him that you love him and that you appreciate what he has done for us, you know, and the thing that he did, the choice that he made to come here and to do the Father's will. You know, he clearly spoke about how if we had seen him, we'd seen the Father, and that he did not speak his own words, but he spoke the words of the Father. And so these things that he said that are in these first few books of the Bible that give his history and give the words of Christ in red, you know, these words that he spoke to those men. And, you know, you and I were talking about, and I've talked to others also about the fact that when Christ was walking and he saw Peter and these men fishing, you know, we talk about predestination and about these things and about God, what God is doing for us, even though somehow we have these choices. But, you know, when Christ came and he found Peter and these men fishing, and he said, hey, come with me and I'm going to make you fishers of men. At that very moment, the Son of God knew that that was a death sentence on these men, because not only would they stop their lives short of everything they were trying to do, but they would literally die for Christ.
Right.
In the whole process of all this. You know, he knew it at that very moment when he was talking to them, while they were sitting and eating fishes that were cooking on an open campfire. And while they were joking and laughing together and fellowshipping together, Christ knew that these very men who he loved so very much were going to give their lives for the gospel. And there are so many people, you know, as you and I have talked over and over again, you know, about people and how they seem to, they don't want to make any kind of sacrifice, no matter how small. You know, it's just so hard to give the Lord any time. It's so hard for me to make a little way for this king, this great king that has came. And he lived these short few years of his ministry, and then he died for us in the most horrible manner that any man could be, you know, die. He was destroyed as a human being, and he was spit upon, and he was cursed at, and he was mocked and made fun of. And we have this hard time, at my lunch hour or my break time or spending a little time after work, you know, and tell mama and the kids, look, daddy needs to spend a little time, or mama needs to spend some time in here, you know, in prayer and talking to the Lord. We can't do that. We can't find any time, you know. And then Sunday, it's all about, when's the sermon going to be over, and I can get out of this place and get home and watch the game or do whatever I've got to do. You know, there's no true dedication on most cases. I'm not saying everybody, but a lot of people are like that. And, you know, the Lord, he knew that when he was choosing these men, that they were going to make the ultimate sacrifice, you know. And I really think that goes to the heart of any of this stuff, you know, that the Lord wants us to worship him as God, as the creator, as our father, as this, you know, Christ was the one who laid down his life for us, you know. And how many times do we cheat him, not only out of tithes and offering, but we also cheat him out of the very time that we need to give him as our savior, you know. When we think about nothing but escape, we don't think about, hey, I could be doing this for others, I could be doing his work while I'm here, because there's so many things, there's so, you know, the need is huge for each and every one of us to act, to reach out with our whatever we can do, you know, no matter what it is. That God doesn't judge that. He judges on what you do. Let me see. Let me try this. Let me do this. He's looking to see if you're even going to make an effort, you know, with that talent that you have. What can you do? So I really believe that's the true, you know, message for people in these last hours before the Lord returns, is to get out there and to do something for him in his name, and to spend time with this savior of ours, you know, the creator of the universe. You have the opportunity to bow your knee and lift your face towards heaven and communicate with God Almighty himself, with his son, you know. And there's so many things that are hidden in his word that people overlook. You know, they read the word and they don't see these beautiful things that God has given us, and these promises that the Lord has given us, you know. And so many people, Patrick, they see their lives, you know, and they see all the negative things happening, and they wonder, why isn't God doing this, you know? And you look at Paul, the apostle, the man that wrote 2/3 of the New Testament, and he had this problem with his eyesight. And the problem was caused by the Lord when he blinded him. And Paul had a hard time seeing, and he had this horrible thing, and God didn't heal him. Was Paul a sinner? No. God had another reason for that, you know. And so many times, God does whatever he has to do to get us to become humble and to seek him. You know, he's telling us, seek me, you know. And so a lot of times things are there for us to seek the Lord, or for people, other people to see that, and then it gives them the opportunity to pray for this brother or that sister and to love one another, you know. And then that is the true grace of God, for us to take each other's burdens, like the Lord said, you know. When you see a brother that's having a problem, or you see some kind of horrible thing happening in the world, to seek the Lord in this, to pray God's will in this thing, to gather together in groups and make an honest effort at trying to do something with this, you know?
Amen. Amen. You know, it was just like what you're saying. I mean, in James, I think I mentioned this the other day, I can't remember when, but you know, in James chapter 5, where it talks about anointing people with oil, it says, you know, there's lots of lessons in that text, but we were talking about the other day, we were talking about Elijah in that text. It says that, you know, Elijah was in like passions as us, but yet, you know, he's talking about James chapter 5, about the prayer of a righteous man availeth much. And even though Elijah wasn't perfect, and he even ran and hid from Jezebel, but yet he was a righteous man, and his prayers had great effect. And then that text, it says that if there's any sick among you, call for the elders of the church, anointing them with oil in the name of the Lord. And then it says, and the prayer of faith will heal the sick. So faith, of course, that's a whole lesson. But it says, in the next verse, it says, and if they've committed any sins, they will be forgiven them.
So,
and then when Jesus healed the blind man on his mat, and that's in Matthew chapter 9, where he first meets Matthew. That's how I remember which text it's in. Just a little clue how sometimes I can remember Bible verses. It's because, you know, Matthew's first name or Hebrew name is Levi. So he's introduced in Matthew chapter 9 as Levi, the tax collector. And there's a man on a mat there, and Jesus tells him, son, be of good cheer. Your sins are forgiven you. And then those old Pharisees said to him, said amongst themselves, who is this guy to forgive sins, you know? I think we lost Brother Gary. Only God can.
No, you didn't.
Oh, I'm sorry.
I'm here.
Okay, great. Only God can forgive sins. And then he said, so which is it easier, to tell someone their sins are forgiven or get up and walk? So that you may know that the Son of Man has power on earth to forgive sins. You know, he tells the guy, arise, take your mat and go home. You know, so the sin is also connected to, you know, as we know, Jesus, God sent the curse on the earth because of the sin of Adam and Eve. So, you know, the fall. So sin and sickness and disease all go together hand in hand. And but it's not always, as the disciples asked Jesus with the blind man, they said, why is this man blind? Is it because of his sin or the sins of his parents? And then Jesus said, neither, but so that the Son of Man would be glorified. So,
Amen.
So there are times, and that's the whole thing about like with Job. I mean, as Gary's trying to say, that's the whole point. You know, ours is not the reason why, but to do or die. I mean, God wants us to be closer to him. And sometimes he allows circumstances, whether it be sickness, disease, whatever it may be, to transform us to the image of Christ. So even though Gary and I are both spirit-filled, you know, Pentecostal people, and we believe that God, unless God tells us otherwise, his will is to heal us, unlike what he's mentioned about the Apostle Paul, where the Lord told him, you know, three times, my grace is sufficient for thee. I believe if the Lord doesn't tell you that, his will is to heal you. But as Brother Gary is saying, in the process of you being healed, you know, you're seeking God. And that's ultimately what God wants. He wants us to seek him. You know, and sometimes he uses, unfortunately, because of our hard-headedness and our laziness, he has to use these unfortunate circumstances to draw us near to him. But ultimately, as Gary and I were saying the other day too, another point of this, the tribulation period is the ultimate act of God's grace. Because millions of people, including not just the Israelites, but millions and millions and millions of people is going to get saved because of the tribulation. When they see the mark, what they read about in the Bible or heard about, then they see it happening. They see all the pestilences and famines and all that. They'll be forced to make a choice. You know, choose the Lord or choose the devil and take the mark, you know, whichever one. And so ultimately, the tribulation is the ultimate example of what, to the world, oh, God is so mean. Why did he send a flood? God is so mean. I don't want to follow a God that would send a tribulation. But actually, in the eyes of Christ, in the mind of God that we're supposed to have, we can see that it's an ultimate act of mercy, not cruelty, but mercy, that God would give people that ultimate shove or push to exercise their free will one way or the other.
Amen.
I'm just laughing because what Gary's talking about, and I laugh about this too when I first started making videos, and I was talking about, you know, predestination versus free will and all that, and someone said, are you a Calvinist? And I'm as Calvinist as the Bible is Calvinist. I mean, the Bible is not clearly total free will, and it's not clearly that, and you're not a robot.
Nope. Amen.
But it's somewhere in between. And God customizes and tailors a plan for each one of us, and he knows that what it would take for us to respond or not to him.
Amen.
You know, and like Brother Gary, we both have relatives, and we've talked about relatives that we have that we know that they will never get saved if there wasn't for the tribulation. We know that. But during the tribulation, we believe the seed that we've sown, and God's plan is to use them as a tribulation saint.
Amen.
That's their destiny, based on the fact that they rejected Christ until the tribulation.
Yes, amen. Yeah.
And our hope is in that. I hope a lot of you guys, too, you got lost family. And Brother Gary, I'm glad that the Lord reminded me to talk about that, because we both have family. You more than me, you know. We have relatives who we know, unless they repented.
Loved ones, yes.
Loved ones that's going into the tribulation, unless they were to repent, which it seems like they're not. They're God haters, I guess is the right word.
Oh, yeah.
Very militantly anti, but they know the truth. And we believe and pray and ask and believe in the promises of God, you know, that they will be saved, but through tribulation.
Right.
And so I know there's a lot of you guys out there in the same boat. I was going to let you, I was going to be quiet and let you talk.
Well, that's the thing, it's just that there's so much, you know, that really needs to be said. Like you were saying, you know, we could probably do a teaching every day on some aspect of these things that the Lord has said, you know. And it could be in depth, you know. We could do some kind of a lesson plan and really have this
right
thing lined up, you know, so that people could see that how God is moving, you know, and how, you know, the inner workings of just the two of us, you and I, praying together and talking to the Lord and seeking the Lord. And they can all do the same thing. You know, they can break up into little groups and they can, you know, pray together and they can work towards these things to try to pull down these strongholds of the enemy. And they can, you know, they can pray for these Christians who are going to be, you know, murdered tonight and tomorrow and the next day, you know, and these people's faith and how they can, you know, they can pray for the Holy Spirit to,
right,
you know, fall on these people, that the wives and the husbands and the children and all those people, they can pray for them. You see, God shows us in the scriptures, you know, the scripture about how the tears are captured and the prayers of the saints and all these things are released in the end and all these things. So, you know, what we do now really counts, even though we don't know that, you know, we don't see any kind of, sometimes any kind of physical result, but we know that God's word is true and that his very character is one of love and of mercy, and that he's trying whatever he can do without violating their free will to save them. And so what we do by our prayers and our push, you know, paying this thing forward, there was a great movie about this, paying this thing forward with this child and how it did this miracle thing. And we can do that as Christians, you know, with our faith, by moving that forward and talking to the Lord each day and seeking God and really crying out to him, you know, and with our tears and in desperation that, God Almighty, listen to my voice. I am here talking to you about these things that are important to my heart. And that's what really God wants, because God knows, Patrick, he knows that each and every one of us are limited by our humanity, by this thing. And that's what Paul really was talking about. And that's the whole point of the rapture and all that stuff, is the fact that the corruptible puts on incorruption. And he changed, you know, because we have those two natures, that sin nature that's dragging us down every day and trying to destroy our lives and our walk with Christ. And then there's that other nature, that thing that Christ did to our spirit man, you know, and those two things are warring one with another. And that's what I really look forward to, and I know that you do too, that one day when that flesh is put down forever and it's changed, and to be like Christ, you know, so we no longer have that constant tug of what this thing wants to do, you know, and what it's trying, how it's trying to destroy our lives. And so Christ knows that. He was here. He was one of us. He experienced it firsthand as God and as fully as man. He saw these things. And so he knows. And so he can be that mediator between us and God, because he can go and he can say, look, I was there, Father. I was in their position and you sent me. That's the thing. It was the will of God. God said, my will is to send my son to redeem those who are on the face of the earth, all that would believe, you know, and come right to me. And so that's what we have. We know that that's his very character. So we can pray his will. We can say, look, we know this is your will, God, in that you sent your very own son to come to this earth to die for us. So when I am praying for this salvation, for this cleansing, for this thing each and every day, whenever I'm watching myself and I'm praying for your people and I'm doing these things, I know that I'm in the will of God. And God enjoys that. He's like, look, there's one of mine down there doing what I want him to do. You know, and whether you see your prayers have an effect or not, they do. You know, you and I talked about Daniel and how he had had this dream and he fasted and sought the Lord for 21 days. And the angel came to him and said, hey, you know, I was withheld. I was withstood by this other evil angel for 21 days until Michael came to help me. And right. So we know that God is doing things, and sometimes they're on grand scales. You know, when Daniel talked about some of these things, it was hundreds of years in the future that things were going to happen in other prophecies. So, you know, what kind of short lifespan we have, and we think, well, God isn't doing anything, but he really is. You know, we can have faith in that, and we can have peace in our hearts that the Lord really is there, and he does listen, and he does care, and he's moving these things forward, you know, and it's our job to band together as brothers and sisters and pray for one another and do that foot watching that that Christ did for his disciples, you know, and really love each other and care deeply about each other and the needs that we have. So, you know, that's Amen. Basically what I thought about saying.
Amen. Amen. It's absolutely true, everything you said. Yeah, that's just a, you know, a quick kind of an overview about half of, well, one-tenth of what the Lord taught us. The Lord was giving us such awesome stuff that
it was amazing.
I know, and I guess, you know, the Lord, we didn't record it, and, you know, the Lord probably maybe doesn't want it all out like that, the way he gave it to us. You know, that's the thing about it, the kind of the downside, brothers and sisters of YouTube. Of course, I can't hardly control who would see it and not, and I don't know who the Lord wants to see it or not. There are people that, you know, that are very mature in the Lord, and the Lord can really edify them at a different level, you know, and there are people who are contentious in the body of Christ and things like that. And, you know, that's, you know, the downside of all these things, because the Lord said, don't cast your pearls before swine. And, you know what, you know, there are swine on YouTube, no doubt. And when the, you know, the apostles walk the earth or anybody, you know, we have, people who want to stone us, who want to, insult God's people and attack. And as, Jesus said, the day's coming, they think when they kill you, they're doing God's service, you know? We have that already, even in Christianity, in the Christian world, much less when you start dealing with ISIS and all that, of course. There's lots of people that are, you know, they don't think of, and that's a whole nother topic. I don't know why people can't think about the motive in their heart. There's so many people that think that it's their job to go around bashing Christians. And, you know, they just got saved themselves a few years ago or 6 months ago or whatever. And, you know, and that's what I always tell people. You want to go after false prophets, why don't you go talk about Muhammad? Make videos about Muhammad. You know, go over there to Iraq and stand on a street corner and tell them about what a false prophet Muhammad was. Because Muhammad said that God has no son. And, you know, he's really, you know, an antichrist spirit that he was operating in. Yeah, so go tell them. And then, of course, you got closer to home, you got Jehovah's Witnesses, you got Mormonism. You got these other kind of things that you could go after. Plenty of cults in the world to go after instead of attacking other Christians over. You know, I've heard from the craziest things that, oh, if you don't use the King James, you're going to hell. If you don't believe in the flat earth, you won't be raptured. I heard that one the other day. That's what got me started looking at the flat earth theory, because I had two different people tell me that you have to believe in the flat earth to be saved. And I didn't read that in the Gospels, but I still thought it was really interesting, and I thought I would just see how big of a deal it was, and come to find out it's actually a huge, huge movement on YouTube right now, is this flat earth theory that I talked about at the beginning of the video. And so, brothers and sisters, that's what we're trying to say, I guess. Our priorities need to be on the Lord himself. And I say this, I've said this before, and I've had some people say, oh, we got to follow doctrine. Look, I'm a preacher. I went to school. I know all about the doctrines, you know, and more than probably almost anybody watching this video. But I'm telling you, when we get to heaven, it's not about doctrines. It's about the maker of doctrines, you know? Mm-hmm. It's the Lord himself. You know, it's not about being healed, but the healer. Or salvation, mm-hmm. but the salvation giver, the deliverer, the Lord. It's about the person of Jesus Christ. You know, so that's why I always laugh to, smile to myself when I go out in the Philippines. I've done evangelism with Baptist pastors, and they always, start telling people, oh, you need to have a personal relationship with Jesus Christ, which is true. But then when you start talking about healing or answered prayer and all these kind of things, God doesn't do that anymore. God doesn't do that anymore. So, I mean, is it a personal relationship with him or not? You know, yeah. Let's talk to him. Let's don't talk about him. Let's talk to him. You know, yeah. It's like the difference between a praise song and a worship song. And that's why you see, even though the Lord anoints praise music too, but most of your hymnals and all that, which I like those hymnal songs, are about the Lord, are about doctrines and things like that. They're not to the Lord, singing to the Lord, you know, and worshiping the Lord, not talking about him or knowing about him, but knowing him. You know, brothers and sisters, I've used that analogy a long time ago. I used to use it for years and years when I first started preaching. I would say, hey, I could go read all the books there are about President Bush. I could read everything. I could interview all of his relatives. I could tell you what size shoe he wears, what's his favorite color, what's his favorite food. But if he walked into the room, he wouldn't know me. He wouldn't say, oh, hey, Patrick, how you doing? Yeah, what are you doing? I haven't seen you since last week. No, President George Bush doesn't know me. And I don't know him. I just know all about him from reading about it. The only way for me to know George Bush is to talk to him and get to know him, spend time with him, to walk with him and talk with him in the cool of the day. And then I could say, well, yeah, President Bush and I, we're buddy buddies, man. We go golfing every Sunday afternoon, right? Or every Saturday, whatever, you know, is your the day of the Lord that you have. Mm-hmm. Spend at least that one day a week with the Lord. That's what we're trying to say, you know. Even though we went through all these complicated ideas and deeper things, it always goes down to the simple fact that the Lord wants us to walk with him in the cool of the day. That's what his desire is, to have fellowship with mankind. He chooses to do that. And we should be so grateful that God, the creator of the universe, would want to talk to us, especially when the fact that what we've done in our lives, we've all sinned and falling short of the glory of God, but yet he would still choose to save us and redeem us and know us and take us to heaven and all that. You know, so we have an open door. God has an open door policy. You imagine you have a chance to talk to the creator of the universe every day and then you don't.
Amen.
You know what I'm saying? Yes. I mean, what if, of course, President Obama's not a very popular president, but, you know, let's just say that, you could go to the White House anytime you want to go in there and talk to the president. Tell him whatever you think. You can even tell him, I don't like your policies. Whatever. You can go in there. Imagine, because we can tell God there's something that we don't like. I mean, he already knows if we don't like it. He already knows what's in our heart anyway. So there's no secrets with God. So that, I think that's about it, Brother Gary. Yeah.
I think, Patrick, what we're saying is fellowship. You know, God wants and desires our fellowship. That's the whole point of him sending his son, was so that we could have a personal relationship with Christ, so that it was no longer some priest killing an animal once a year for our sins.
Right.
But it was the Savior himself indwelling each and every person, and so that we could have this one-on-one fellowship, this personal relationship with Christ.
Right.
You know, and I think that's, you know, what the Lord, what all of this stuff is that we're doing here, you know, when it all boils down to the end, you know, that is really what it is it's our, you know, like you and I have sat and talked and mused so many times about how, you know, what are we going to do in the kingdom and how it's going to be so wonderful to see Christ and to see the beauty that God has and that place that's uncorrupted, you know, and see the tree of life and that water that runs out of the throne and just all of this beauty, you know, and that we're there. We can have fellowship with our God, with Christ himself, you know, the one who died for us.
And no sin and no
right.
Nothing that, Yeah, we wouldn't, you know, we wouldn't be sinning anymore. We wouldn't be doing things that
Right.
we know God doesn't want us to do, and just there being, you know, being what our spirit desires to be, which is
Yes.
to be perfect and be with Christ.
Amen. Yeah.
It's going to be so awesome, man. I mean, we talked about it last time, and
Yeah.
you know, people really l thought it was hilarious when I said I was going to, you know, just do like Blue the Bear there in the river of life, man. And just imagine that, you know, all of our, like that song, there's an old hymnal song. It was my grandfather's favorite hymnal song, which is the Old Rugged Cross, you know, if you've heard
Oh,
that.
yeah.
And it says, you know, my trophies at last I lay down, you know. So all of our things in this world, man, all of our material possessions, a lot of people are chasing, you know, material blessing, material things.
Oh, yeah.
We know in this world we need a house or a place to live. We need food and all that. We know that. And our husbands, our wives, we need a companionship, you know, we need our family and all that, whatever. But ultimately, all those things in the spirit world, and when we're in our perfect body and our perfected mind and heart, we don't need any of those things. You
Amen.
know, we'll be there with God, and we won't have to worry about, it's just like being a little kid. You know, you don't have to worry about what you're going to eat and what you're going to wear. And I mean, as a matter of fact, the Lord tells us don't do that in this life in the Sermon on the Mount.
Yeah.
Matthew chapter 6, 33, he says, see, you know, don't worry about those material things, but seek ye first the kingdom of God and his righteousness, and he'll give us all
Yes.
those things will be added unto you. So in this life, he will give us those things as we seek him and his righteousness. And that is what we're saying. You know, in this life, seek him and his righteousness, you know, sanctification, separate yourself from sin. And then all the
Yes,
earthly
amen.
things you need, God is just going to give you. But in the and when we get to heaven, you know, we won't even have to worry about that. You know, we won't have to seek him because we'll be there with him. I mean, you know, we won't even have
Amen.
to do that anymore. We're just there, man.
Yeah.
We're gonna be home. We're gonna
That's
be
going to be a
home.
powerful thing. Yes, amen.
Home where my heart is. I don't know the words of the song. That's Simon and Garfunkel song. You know,
Yeah.
home is you're silently waiting or whatever it is. It's gonna be awesome to get there. Into heaven, Gary. And like I said, if as
Amen.
soon as I see you, I'd like to do a high five there, man. And
Yeah,
you know, and say, ha ha, we made
we
it. Believe it
made
or
it.
not,
Amen.
hey, you
Yeah.
know, by the grace of God, we made it. And
That's right. Amen.
it's going to be awesome. It's all his doing, and it's marvelous in our eyes, you know. The Lord is the one who's making the way, and he is the way. I mean, that's pretty
Yeah.
awesome, you know. He made the way himself. He is the way, and he made a way himself. It's just beyond awesome to go there. And that's what I would just like to encourage you, brothers and sisters. You
Right.
know, when we all get to heaven, as the song says, you know, what a day of rejoicing that will be when we all see Jesus. We will sing and shout the victory, is what the song says, one
Amen.
of those old song hymnal
That
songs.
is a great song. It is.
Yeah, when we all see Jesus, it's going to be awesome. I can't wait to get there either, brother. I mean, I don't even like to think about it because I get so excited. As they say, I'm so heavenly minded, I'm no earthly good. You know, I'm just like, you know, it's like when I was in the army, when I was 18, you know, I joined the army, and I was away at Christmas and all that stuff. And of course, you know, I have, you know, like you and I both also share kind of a bad childhood too. So I wasn't overly lonely from being away from home, but I still, you know, had spent my first year away. I remember that. So the feeling that I have for not being in heaven is much stronger than that. The desire to be in heaven is much more great than my desire, oh, to be with, to see my relatives or whoever, even my own wife or whatever. My desire to be with the Lord is much greater than any of those things.
Yes, amen.
You know, because he's going to make everything, it'll all be all right when we get there with him. It's going to be all finished. And I just, can you imagine, you don't have to worry about, you know, like, you know, medical conditions or bills or whatever, you know, sickness, disease, sin, none of that. It'll be like, I mean, it's going to just be over in a blink of an eye, in the twinkling of an eye.
Dear Patrick, it's going to
Yeah, it's going to be really heaven, you know.
be heaven.
I mean, if you love, you know, you think eating a Krispy Kreme donut hot now is heaven, it's
I
nothing, right?
know.
You
Yeah.
know, I mean, just
Yep.
One time I was thinking that it's like heaven is, earth is to heaven as hell is to earth. I mean,
Oh, yeah.
When people, and I made a video, I think, a long time ago about, people who would go to hell. And I've told people who are atheists, my own relatives, I'll say, you think that, there's a where's God at now in this world, blah, blah, blah. And I always tell them, you think that God's not here, but when you get to hell, when there is truly no light at all, no love, no light, then you will realize how much God there actually is in this earth. We just don't realize it because it's all we've ever been in. That there's plenty of God in this earth. Even though it's a fallen world, there's plenty of God in this world. Plenty of love and plenty of light and good things in the creation, even though it's the fall. You know, we're in a fallen world.
Yep.
But I believe, heaven is... earth is already... Compared to hell, earth is already heaven. But multiply that, to the same measure in the opposite direction, heaven is going to make earth seem like hell when we get there. Can you imagine? I mean, like lots of people like you, you've had some medical situations and stuff. People don't realize that they have aches and pains but when it's be suddenly gone and your body would feel perfect like you were 20 years old or whatever, it's going to be a shock.
Oh, yeah.
All those burdens of this world will be gone instantly.
It's going to be a great day.
Man, I can't even. That's why I don't even like to think about it too much. I just, that's why when I pray, that's one reason that the downside I have about praying, it's like I don't want to stop. I don't want to go back down off the mountain, man. I'm like.
Exactly.
Being on the mountain with the Lord, it's where the place, you just want to stay and never go back down.
Yeah, you can hide in him there. People really do themselves a disservice when they don't spend that time to really dig into that, because that's where the Lord is, and you're safe from the world and you're safe from all your problems and everything when you're there in his presence,
Yeah, Psalm 91, verse 1. He who dwells in the secret place of the Most High God shall abide under the shadow of the Almighty. I will say of the Lord, he is my refuge and my strength. My God, in him shall I trust. Yeah, he is our strong tower. Our hiding
place. It's all
place.
In there, man, every bit of it.
He's our hiding place.
Yes,
amen. He is our hiding place, our refuge. Yeah, he's something else. God is something else. God is good. And even when we're, having a bad day, as Jesus said, Peter said, well, what if my brother sins against me? Seven times should I forgive and ask me to forgive him? Should I forgive him? And the Lord said, not seven times, but 70 times, seven times a day. And so no matter what you've done, that's probably one of the biggest questions I get too from people. You can repent, ask the Lord to forgive you and try again and again and again and again and again until you get it right. And don't you do like Adam and Eve and go try to hide your sin and cover your sin and hide from the Lord. Come on out to the Lord and let him know, and don't hide from him, and just come on out.
That's what he really wants.
Yep, come on out, and he'll clean you up. He provided the sacrifice, just like with Adam and Eve. He skinned the animals and gave them something that would cover them properly, not a fig leaf.
It wasn't their own works; those were works of their hands. It was his works that covered them.
That's right, and that's what it is. And I say this all the time, when I evangelize in the Philippines. I mean, what if Adam and Eve had come out and not hid from God and said, we're sorry, we messed up, and take the blame, they took the blame for it. Said, you told us not to, but we did. We're sorry, we shouldn't have. Please forgive us. I mean, what would have happened? I don't know.
Yeah, who knows, man? It could have been a totally different world.
That's right. But instead, they blame. Well, Adam said, the woman you gave me.
Yeah.
She gave me the fruit and I ate it. And he blamed it on the serpent. He tricked me. Yeah. He beguiled me. So, they didn't take the blame for their sin. They blamed the serpent, and they trusted him over God. People do that all the time. That's the problem I have with my relatives who are backsliders and atheists. That they want to trust in themselves. They want to trust in what some human told them instead of trusting in what the Lord says. And it's a fatal mistake with eternal consequences.
Oh, yeah.
Put your faith and trust in the serpent or his people, his children. Well, Brother Gary, I guess we've been going. Maybe we really do need to make a list. I know you've been writing stuff down the last few days, and let's start working off a list. And then I'm going to invite people to put comments on here of topics you would like Brother Gary and I to talk about. Because that's the thing about it, brothers and sisters. There's many of you who have heard me. You've heard Gary, and you kind of know what areas we should be talking about just from the way you know how God uses us, and give us some good ideas of probably an area that we could lay out some good stuff in the area that, you know, God would use us in, you know. Because,
you know, Pastor Patrick, I think that tonight somebody, you know, we're making this message for someone there.
Amen.
And there's probably more than just one person that really, you know, they need to hear about the love of God and Christ, because of the world, you know, the world is such a cruel and dark place at this very moment
Roger.
In time, you know, and people really, really need to know
Amen.
That they have an advocate with God, and that God really does love them, and that it was God's choice to make a way of salvation for each and every one of us, and that he deeply desires to have fellowship with us. You know, like you were talking about Adam and Eve there, you know, the Bible tells us that in the cool of the day, that God himself came down from his throne from heaven, and he walked in the garden seeking Adam and Eve, seeking his creation, those that he loved. He was actively pursuing them, looking for them, you see, because he loved them. He truly did, and he loves each and every one of us, you know, and he demonstrated that throughout the entire Bible over and over again, how he was dealing with man and how he loved men, and he wanted to bring salvation to us and forgiveness to us, and he tried all of these different ways so that he could communicate with us, you know, and tell us that, and eventually that he would have to send his own son to do this work, you know, that he became man himself and
right.
dwelt on earth in the form of Christ and gave us the message directly from the mouth of God. And he gave it not only to the common man, but he gave it to the religious man, the leaders, the Pharisees, the Sadducees. He gave it to the high priest himself and said, this is what you are seeking, this is what you're looking for. And it was just so hard for them to get to understand, because they had all these traditions and all these laws, and hey, you can't be picking any food on the Sabbath day, you know, and all these things, or you can't be healing, or you can't do this, or you can't do that. It was all about that, and who do you say you are? And he says, hey, I'm from God, I came down to speak his words to you, you know. And that's the power of that God Almighty wanted to have fellowship with that which he had created.
Amen, brother. Amen. Amen. Well, you want to you want to pray?
Sure. Yeah, I can.
Okay, go
Dear
ahead.
Dear Heavenly Father, Patrick and I come before you in the mighty name of Yeshua, according to your holy word, where he said, if you ask anything in my name of the Father, I'll grant it. We come together in his name to ask that you would bless those who are listening to this message, that you would fulfill in them the desires of their heart to be close to you, that you would send the Holy Spirit to indwell them, that you'd touch their needs, God, and if they are sick, that you'd heal them, God. If they are lonely, that you would comfort them. Father God, we ask that your presence be with them, to touch them, God, that you would remove all strife in their life, that they would be allowed to see the glory of God, that they'd be allowed to feel the presence of your Holy Spirit in their lives, that you'd bless them on their jobs, that you'd open doors before them so that they might, in the name of Christ, help those that are around them, that they might become a blessing and that they might speak peace, God. We decree, and we release this upon your people, God, that they would be able to have peace in their own homes, that you would be able to touch their loved ones, God, and that you'd be able to do that through peace, God, and no longer through strife, that you do this through love and through kindness, through the power of your word, God, and that each and every one of these individuals who are listening to this, God, that they would have a deep desire to have fellowship with you, God, that it would drive them to their knees, that they would begin to seek you through the power of the Holy Spirit, God, that they would look for sanctification in their lives, God, that they would be touched by the power of Almighty God himself, that you would answer their prayers, God, that you would give them a sense of deep, deep peace in their lives, that they would know that it is you who have chosen to do this, that you wanted to have fellowship with them, that you'd bless them and touch them in a mighty way, that you'd touch their family and their jobs, that you'd give them finances, that you'd give them healing, God, that you'd bless them in the mighty name of Yeshua. We ask it in Christ's name. We ask, amen.
Amen. Amen. Praise God. Next time I'll pray, brothers and sisters.
Okay.
And we'll take turns with it. Well, Brother Gary, I really appreciate it. And, of course, we've had so many awesome conversations that I wish we had, you know, could share or had have recorded it somehow to share, because, you know, when we're going this together, God is just, you know, confirming it by two witnesses here that it's just flowing. So I praise God that we just kind of touched on one part, little parts here tonight. And by the grace of God, we can continue and really go. I think one of these times I want us to get on here and really do some serious praying and, you know, and really flow in the spirit of prophecy and all that like we did before. And some of the words we got were just so awesome that built on the other things the Lord had showed us in the past.
Yes, amen.
And I'd love to share those things if the Lord wants to, or as the Lord will, I'll put it that way, because sometimes the Lord gives us private words, you know, to anybody. And, you know, sometimes it's... That's why you have praying in the spirit, which is, you know, between you and God, edifying God, and then praying in tongues where you need interpretation, because it's for the whole church, you know. So it's the same thing with a word. You know, you could get a word that's just for you or for me, and then it's not for the whole body. But for me, I feel like, you know, when I gave those words of wisdom, I made those videos giving people words. You know, I always try to teach out of that too. You know, trying to let people find out and understand how God speaks to us, and, you know, the way, because God kind of follows, he always follows these patterns, you know that it's him. He puts his signature on it. As we were talking the other day, Gary, about the things that happened with our meeting and the relationship that you and I have had, how God has put his signature on that he, you know, had divinely ordained that we would meet and that we would talk and do some praying together and fellowshipping. And who knows what all ministry or whatever the Lord would have us do together. He ordered that, and then he's given us his signature by the way he did it and the things he showed us that just lined up, that it was beyond, you know, if you have 100 coincidences, there's a point where it's not a coincidence. It's the divine hand of God, or providence, as they say, where God would line it up. And so it's so awesome, brothers and sisters. If the Lord wills, I'd like to talk about all those things in the future, because... the reason, like I said, is because, you know, the Lord has kind of made me a pastor. And so it always comes into my spirit when I'm talking about those things. You know, what can everybody learn from that? And what can they learn about God and their own personal walk with the Lord, and how, you know, to better understand God and to hear from him, you know, themselves, each of us individually. You know, so as they say, the quickest way to wisdom is not through experience, but through mentorship. And that's why God gave us the ministries, so that we wouldn't have to, you know, spend years and years with experience. If we have someone who has years of experience, could mentor us in a short amount of time and save us years of hardship, you know, and perilous ground through learning the hard way, as they say.
Amen.
You know, and so I thank the Lord for that. You know, there's people that's given me a lot of wisdom. You know, as they say, if I wanted to know how to start an international software company, even though Bill Gates is an atheist, I would probably go to Bill Gates if he would, you know, mentor me in how to start a software company or somebody like that, because that's his thing. You know, he's an expert in that area, and that's who I'd go to. You know, if I wanted to find out, if I wanted to find about being a real estate mogul, I guess I would call Donald Trump, you know, and ask him how to do it because he was successful at it, you know, brothers and sisters. And so there are people that are successful in hearing from the Lord or walking with the Lord or whatever, and that's the people we want to fellowship with and hear from them to mentor us to bypass some of the, you know, the hardships of learning the hard way. There's no need to learn in the hard way if someone can show you. Like Elijah and Elisha, right? You know, Elijah trained Elisha and speeded up the process of him, you know, going to the level of in God that he did from observing Elijah. Anyway, brothers and sisters, I think we'll wrap this one up. Is that, what do you think, Gary? You ready to?
Yeah.
Yeah, it's already been going a long way.
I really think we did, you know. Yeah. I really think it was good for a lot of people, Patrick.
Amen. Amen. I think it was a good video. So I'm going to cut it off now. Okay.
All right.
All right. God bless everybody. We'll see you again next time by the grace of God. And I hope you all enjoy it. Please put your comments or questions of stuff you'd like, if you feel like the Lord would use Brother Gary and myself to try to hear from the Lord about, etc. We could also pray. I've got words for people before. How about this? People would put comments of a question they want to ask God. Now, lots of times we can answer it biblically without having to pray. You know, I'm saying, oh, God, or did Jesus die on the cross? Well, the Bible says he did. We don't need to ask that. But there are things that maybe we can pray about that or something. Kind of exercise our spiritual gifting here for the body of Christ and kind of flow it and see what happens. Who knows? So we're looking forward to your suggestions, too, and your comments. God bless.